and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Joining me this week is Clay Jenkinson, the director of the Dakota Institute. Clay, thanks for joining us today.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
As we get started, Clay, for the folks out there that may not know you, tell us a little bit about yourself and your background.
Well, I'm a North Dakotan. I grew up in Dickinson. I left the state for quite a number of years, more than two decades, really. But I always wanted to come home, and 5 years ago I found a way, and now I've made the best decision that I've ever made. I'm going to spend the rest of my life in western North Dakota.
And while so many people are probably watching right now and thinking, Clay Jenkinson, Jefferson Hour is, can you just briefly tell us?
I'm the creator of the Thomas Jefferson Hour and Thomas Jefferson. Mm-hmm. I portray historical figures, Meriwether Lewis, Theodore Roosevelt, Thomas Jefferson, J. Robert Oppenheimer, and others. And probably a lot of people have heard the Jefferson Hour on your radio network. But I also lecture around the country and teach college classes and write books and so on. But at the moment, most of my work is directing the Dakota Institute at Fort Mandan and also heading up a Roosevelt initiative at Dickinson State University.
All right, and with that, what is the Dakota Institute and when was it founded?
The Dakota Institute is a subsidiary of the Lewis and Clark Fort Mandan Foundation. It was created by my friend David Borlaug. We've known each other for a very long time, and we had a lot of work together during the bicentennial of Lewis and Clark. But when I returned 5 years ago, we talked, and he said, let's create a nonprofit entity that will produce documentary films, lecture series and symposiums, we'll create exhibits, we'll raise a conversation about the history and the future of North Dakota, and we'll publish books. And our press actually just released its first book 2 weeks ago, a book about Lewis and Clark in the Columbia River Basin. We're going to publish 3 to 5 books per year and produce at least one documentary film per year.
Okay, and with that, you've already done one documentary.
Did one.
Can you tell us just briefly about that?
Yeah, it was a great project, a labor of love. It was a biographical portrait of former North Dakota Governor Arthur Link, an agrarian who in 1973 and 1974 staked his whole life, his whole political career, on slowing down the coal industry and making sure that we had proper reclamation practices in North Dakota. And he gave a famous speech, When the Landscape is Quiet Again, which was the centerpiece of our film.
Okay, but that's not the one we're here to talk about today. Today, I understand you're currently working on a new documentary on former Governor William Guy. Can you tell us about how that's going and when it's going to premiere?
Well, it will premiere soon. It's going to be on Prairie Public on the 25th of June, and there are two theater premieres in June. But let me first say who Bill Guy is. Bill Guy was the governor of North Dakota between 1960 and 1972. All of the dozens of historians and commentators that we have talked with, we've interviewed, have said the same thing, that he's probably the most important governor of North Dakota after World War II. He's the one that brought us into modern government and into the modern world. He presided over the great interstate highway boom, the Minuteman missile sites around North Dakota, great boom in education. He regionalized mental health care. He reorganized government and created our first Office of Management and Budget in North Dakota. He is the person who sort of lifted us out of our agrarian, isolated status and brought us into the 20th century in a big way. So the title of our film is The Charisma of Competence. A former North Dakota historian, Larry Remley, said he wasn't a brilliant orator, he's not a flashy man, no big vision, but he had great administrative mastery, or what might be called the charisma of competence. So I've been working on this film now for a year and a half, and we're just in the editing process now, taking 150 hours of interview and squeezing them into a one-hour documentary.
Well, obviously now you said you did Art Link first and now Bill Guy. So it's what, you know, why did you pick Bill Guy? And maybe is there sort of a theme going here or what's?
Well, there are two former governors.
Yeah.
They're both Democrats, but that's just incidental. We don't have any political agenda of any sort. I chose Art Link because he's always been a hero of mine. And then I wanted to do Bill Guy because he's of such extraordinary importance. And frankly, they're both in their senior years and now's the time to do this while they still can be interviewed and participate. So this is the second film. We won't always be doing former governors or political figures. So we're going to do a big documentary that's already underway on Eric Severide, the great CBS News commentator and one of the inventors of broadcast news. We're working on the Harold and Shyla Schaefer family. Shyla Schaefer lives in Bismarck. She's a very dear friend of mine, and she's one of the most remarkable people I've ever met in my life. So we're doing a documentary on that. We're going to do something about the future of the Badlands, about the history of North Dakota. You know, we'll be all over the map, but for the moment, we're concentrating on these governors.
Okay. Well, with that, I understand we may have a clip here that we're going to see. Can you tell us a little bit about what all we're going to maybe look at, or we just want to go to the clip? What would you like to
Let me just say that this was a short piece that we used to build support for funding of the film and also to get people excited about the project. It really kind of covers the ground of the charisma of competence.
Okay. Well, let's take a look at that clip right now.
When we think of Bill Guy, we think of him striding onto the campus of the University of North Dakota on September 25, 1963, in lockstep with President John F. Kennedy, just a few weeks before Kennedy's assassination in Dallas.
Governor Guy, Senator Burdick, I am confident I'm talking to the future rulers of not only North Dakota, but the United States.
When we think of Bill Guy, we think of him traveling to South Vietnam as a personal representative of President Lyndon Johnson in 1967 to monitor the first elections in that country's history, and having the courage, upon returning to the United States, to tell President Johnson and Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara that the war was in danger of being lost.
I don't have to tell you that North Dakota has untold and untouched wealth in oil and lignite. There is much to be done toward converting this potential mineral wealth into money wealth for the people of this state.
Bill Guy represents progress. Highways, concrete, and steel. Coal, oil, and water development, and agricultural enterprise. He represents reform, good government, and administrative mastery. What the late historian Larry Remley called the charisma of competence.
The torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, proud of our ancient heritage, and unwilling to witness or permit the slow undoing of those human rights to which this nation has always been committed, and to which we are committed today at home and around the world.
And I just think there was a hunger for a certain freshness. And you do see Bill Guy, he's, I believe he's, in, I want to say he's like 42 when he's elected the first time to be governor. He has a young family. I think he has five children, two sons, three daughters. He has an exceptionally attractive wife who has worked as a model in the past. I don't think it's hard for a lot of people to see Jack Kennedy and Bill Guy as being very, very similar. Young Democrats who've served in the Navy, served well in the Navy, a successful farmer. He's fresh. He's vibrant. He's not an old name. And I think there's just something about him at that time. In retrospect, we chose youth and vibrancy. He's got this crew cut, which, you know, 21st century Americans might go, ooh. But in 1960, the crew cut was cool. And so here's a young, vibrant man.
You want to know how Bill Guy started his ascent to become governor of North Dakota? It starts in a very unusual way. In 1960, a big political year, and we're at a dinner party, my wife Fritzy and I, Bill and Jean Guy, with two friends from Fargo, Eli Dobrovich and his wife, June, and we're talking politics. And we're coming into an election year. We're talking about who can we as Democrats get to run as governor. Maybe there's a chance we can elect a Democratic person as governor after all these many years. And we had a nice dinner and we had some drinks. And Eli maybe had a few more than the rest of us. So he laid down on the floor and on the couch. And as we're talking, all of a sudden, Eli gets up on one elbow, raises his right hand, and yells out, "Guy for governor!" Silence. You know, that's a pretty good idea.
Bill Guy is a cut of North Dakota. He is a product of our culture, and he respects our culture and the people that do their best to make a living in North Dakota. And he feels his job is to make that as nearly possible as he can. And so he's a genuine North Dakota product. In fact, we could label him made in North Dakota.
This is the story of Governor William L. Guy. From his roots on a farm at Amenia, North Dakota, Bill Guy came to power with the new frontier in 1960, and he presided calmly and with masterful administration in a northern prairie state through one of the most tumultuous eras in American history. Bill Guy changed the face of North Dakota, not with a grand vision, but by looking around and asking, what are the problems that need to be solved? What's holding us back from becoming a modern progressive state? How can we improve the way we manage government here? And how can we make sure that our citizens feel good about their government and good about North Dakota?
Well, Clay, looks interesting. How is Governor Guy doing these days?
He's 90 years old. He's still great. I've interviewed him for more than 30 hours and also about the same amount of time with his wife, Jean. They live in Fargo in very modest circumstances. He's a very humble man, but he is proud of his achievement for North Dakota, and this film will be an examination of his legacy.
Okay. Well, can you talk some about the, I think you said 30 hours that you spent with him, and some of that, some of the process with that interviewing him, and then who else you interviewed?
Well, we've done the interviews both in Bismarck and in your studios in Fargo. In fact, your own Barbara Gravel has been just a tremendous associate in this project. And the guys have come there. And I've interviewed him for more than 30 hours now, and he talks about his whole life. You know, he was a Navy man. In fact, in World War II, he was on the William D. Porter, and they were escorting FDR to Tehran for the Tehran Conference. And his destroyer accidentally fired a torpedo. at the President of the United States. This is a weird and hilarious incident. Nothing bad came of it. And Bill Guy was in no way responsible for this accident. But that same boat a year later was sunk off Okinawa by a kamikaze raid. So he, like Jack Kennedy, had some serious World War II heroism. Comes back, gets on the school board, kind of pops into the governorship in 1960 and changes the face of this state. So it's just been, it's hard to say it without, you know, feeling a little emotional, but it's been an honor to have that time in your studio with this extraordinary couple. They're married for 67 years now. She is his partner in every possible way, and he is still interested in the future of North Dakota. He's still working on water, trying to make sure you get water into the Red River to stabilize that system.
Hmm. And who else did you interview throughout this process?
Oh, you saw Kimberly Porter from UND. Mm-hmm. She's been in several other of your projects. Mike Jacobs, one of our sort of our go-to guy, the editor of the Grand Forks Herald, one of my oldest friends, but absolutely brilliant on these questions. Tracy Potter in Bismarck, Joe Satram, the governor, John Hoeven, Senator Dorgan, and Congressman Pomeroy. One of our last interviews will be with Kent Conrad. So historians, contemporaries, people who know something about that era of North Dakota history and who could reflect back on Bill Guy's legacy and achievement.
Well, and I know your previous documentary you mentioned about Governor Art Link. Was it just sort of a natural lead-in to do Bill Guy, was it planned, or how did that really come about?
A little bit accidentally. I knew I wanted to do a documentary on Art Link because I think that his conservation ethic was essential to what North Dakota is, and that we need that. We need that voice still in our discourse as we move into this extraordinary industrialization of the Great Plains through the Bakken oil field and increased energy development. But when you talk about Art Link, Bill Guy comes up over and over and over again. And I can remember in 1968 at the Democratic National Convention in Chicago, I was just a child in Dickinson, North Dakota. And Bill Guy announced the vote for the president from the delegation in North Dakota. And he said famously, North Dakota that is cleaner and greener in the summer and whiter and brighter in the winter. And at that moment, all North Dakotans felt pride because he had lifted us into the national arena. So one of the themes of this film is that Bill Guy is not just a great governor, he's a national figure. He was a friend to LBJ and went to Vietnam on LBJ's behalf. He was a close friend of JFK, and he and Gene tell hilarious stories about going to dinners at the White House with the Kennedys. So this was not just a governor. You know, most governors, the historians have told us, are caretakers, and they mean no disrespect by that, but we have a weak constitutional governorship in North Dakota. Bill Guy made the most of it. He used the bully pulpit. He created the Rough Rider Award. He was the creator of the Midwest Governors Conference. He was the chairman of the National Governors Conference. So this is a man who deserves this sort of treatment, and I'm just lucky to be able to do it.
Hmm. Well, I know in 1974, of course, Bill Guy ran against North Dakota Senator Milton Young in the Senate race and narrowly lost. How did that sort of affect Bill Guy and his future then? And
that's such a great question. You know, he was in his early 50s. He had been governor for 12 years, elected four times. He was on this trajectory that would almost inevitably have taken him to the Senate. And he stood for the Senate and the Democratic platform in 1974 against popular but old incumbent Milton R. Young. He should have won. It was the year of Watergate. He lost by a heartbreaking number of votes, I think 186 votes. There was a contested recount not so different from that in the year 2000 in the presidential campaign. And it broke his heart, I think. And he doesn't talk about it. He's a stoic. But you just get the sense that that broke his heart. And it's one of the most fascinating elections in North Dakota history. There was a spoiler, Jim Jungroth of Jamestown, who had been a Democratic chairman in North Dakota, ran an independent campaign on an environmental platform. And he took about 7,000 votes away. And almost all of those votes came from Bill Guy. So Milton R. Young was reelected, no problem there. But one of our most extraordinary men had his political career stalled out by this just remarkably dramatic election. And the impact of that is still being felt in North Dakota today.
Well, you mentioned about his relationship with President Kennedy and his an opportunity to, I guess, be at the White House and do a lot of things with him. But did you get a sense for what it was, what kind of loss it was for Bill Guy when President Kennedy was shot in 63?
Yes, and some of this footage will all this footage will wind up in the State Historical Society. It's an important historical document. Not much of it can get into the film, but we spent a long time talking about Kennedy, and you saw in the clip that, President Kennedy was here in September of 63, just 2 months before he was martyred in Dallas. And I just had an interview last week in Fargo with Bill Guy, and he said, you know, we were looking at this photograph of the two of them walking on the campus of UND, and I said, well, you know, how did the day end? And he said, well, I put him on that airplane, and I never saw him again. And then there was this pause, and I said, what did John Kennedy represent for this country? And Bill Guy broke down, and it was just incredibly moving, because even now, what, 50 years later, this moment in American history is a deeply felt one for him. He was in Omaha when the news came at a governor's conference. He actually then just spontaneously flew to Washington, D.C. to pay his respects to the family. And he had to borrow money at the airport even to get a ticket to go to D.C. This is, I mean, John Kennedy is a central figure in our national history. He's a very central figure in Bill Guy's life, and the friendship, you know, was something deeper than just political expediency. So that it's been very moving to hear that story. We won't use the saddest parts of it in the film, of course, but it's an important story.
Well, and we alluded to his World War II experiences, Bill Guy's, and maybe the relationship with Kennedy is what they shared and bonded them, but what part of Bill Guy's experiences in World War II will be in the documentary, or will it?
Won't be much room for that, of mm-hmm. course. You have to do an awful lot of jumping and marching to get through a whole life, and an important life like this in an hour. But I do want to tell the story of the William D. Porter. It's a very interesting story. You know, after that incident where they nearly sent a torpedo into the USS Iowa, which was carrying the President of the United States, everyone on the ship was under house arrest. There was an investigation. Imagine what would happen today with Fox and CNN and MSNBC on this story. It was actually covered up for 14 years. It wasn't until 1958 that story ever became known to the American people. It's the only time in our history that our troops have fired on a sitting president of the United States. Accidentally, of course, but, you know, so we'll tell that story in the film. And we're making the JFK parallel. When JFK was asked why he became a naval hero, he said, they sank my boat. Very self-effacing about it. And Bill Guy is the same way. You know, the greatest generation doesn't like to talk about that story in a self-important way. But that's part of what gave him the leadership capacity, along with his education. He got a graduate degree at the University of Minnesota in ag economics. To have the vision to create the modern North Dakota.
Remind us again, when will this documentary premiere, and will tapes be available?
Yes, of course.
Or DVDs,
I guess. We'll be selling DVDs, just as we did of the ArtLink film. There's a premiere in Fargo at the Fargo Theater on the 15th of June, and people can come to that, and the guys will be there, and it'll be a gala event. Then it will be premiered in Bismarck at the Bell Mayhew Auditorium on the 22nd of June, and then on the 25th, you're airing it on Prairie Public, and we're just thrilled. And so that'll be the beginning, I think, of a large number of airings. But we'll also have the DVD, and people can purchase that either at the site or in bookstores and grocery stores, or they can go to the Fort Mandan website and get it.
Well, Clay, you've got a fun job, it sounds like.
The best job in the world.
But let's go back to the Dakota Institute just a minute. Yeah. Let's talk about the funding again. How is the Dakota Institute funded?
Well, Fort Mandan is a 501c3. We have people who come through the door, but we also get donations. David Borlaug is a genius at fundraising, and he does the hard work. He's the executive producer of these films. I get the fun job. I get to make them. He has to go out and raise the money, but he's good at it. And so we have funding for about four more films after this one.
Well, and speaking of that, I want to. What are the things you talked about? Eric Severide documentary that you're working on, but we're probably talking a number of years possibly before that ever comes.
Two,
to pass.
I think his centennial is 2012.
Okay.
And so here's what we're doing. We're having a symposium this fall in Bismarck, September 30th through October 3rd, on Eric Severide, and great people are coming. People of national prominence: Bob Schieffer, Nick Clooney. Biographers of Severide and his third wife, Suzanne St. Pierre Severide, are all coming for that symposium. So people should put that on their mental map. Then there will be this film that'll air in 2012. I've already interviewed Dan Rather and Tom Brokaw and Rita Braver and Charles Osgood and many, many more yet to come. And we'll use footage from his famous commentaries on CBS. For 14 years, he was the voice of America, the conscience of America. next to Walter Cronkite. And then there's going to be a book. I'm editing an anthology of Severide's writings for his centennial, because he's a brilliant writer. I mean, in his final broadcast, Walter Cronkite said maybe he's the best essayist in America of the 20th century. So there'll be an anthology too.
Well, Clay, I wish we had more time, but fine, if people want more information, where can they go?
Just Google Fort Mandan Foundation or Dakota Institute and you'll see it. But don't forget the premieres on the 15th of June and the 22nd in Fargo and Bismarck, and the world premiere airing on Prairie Public on the 25th. We're thrilled.
Clay, thanks so much for joining us today.
Hey, my delight. Thank you.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse this week. And as always, thanks for watching.